all get to heaven. Isn't it wonderful? I know sometimes, you know, I'll be there at the house, and there's an excitement when you think about what tomorrow is. You know, there is an excitement. When we know the Lord, there is an excitement, and we're thankful. So let's just worship God. Thank you, Jesus.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Use this one. Who feels the Holy Ghost here this morning? Go ahead and lift up your hands and your voices in the presence of the Lord. Thank God the Holy Ghost anointing is here. Come on, let's praise Him. Father, we love and appreciate You this morning, O Lord. God, we're thankful that, God, we already feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost. God, we ask, O Lord, in the name of Jesus, that, God, You'll stretch forth Your hand, God, in this class. God, I pray You'll bless every brother, every sister. God, we pray You'll meet every need, and in all things the will of God will be done. We ask it in Jesus' name. Go ahead and clap your hands unto the Lord. Somebody shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Thank God the Holy Ghost is here this morning. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I'll tell you what, I've been feeling the Holy Ghost all morning. My wife and I were out eating. I didn't tell her. She said, "Are you all right?" But I was already under the anointing of God while we were eating breakfast this morning. I thank God for that distinct, I'll use the word crisp, presence and anointing of God. Do you believe our God is a quickening spirit? Thank God when He touches things, they come alive. Do you love Him? Clap your hands one more time. Woo! Oh, Brother Johnson, I feel the Holy Ghost very strong right now. God's got great things for this church. God's got great things for our services and our classes today. I believe that, Brother England, with all of my heart. And today we're going to look at a man by the name of John the Baptist. And he, the scripture says, was the greatest prophet ever, in so many words. Our title is John the Baptist. Everyone say, no greater prophet. That's what we're going to look at this morning. You can be seated in the name of the Lord, and I will slow it down some. But again, John the Baptist, no greater prophet. And this is the last of the study on the Hebrew prophets. We've been studying them for the last 3 months or so. And so now we're going to look at John the Baptist. And he is the last of the Old Testament prophets and the forerunner of Jesus Christ. The Bible says in John chapter 10 and verse 41 that he did no miracle. Even though he came in the spirit and power of Elijah, and Elijah means my God is Jah, my God is Jehovah. Even though he came in the spirit and power of Elijah, he did no miracle. He wrote no scripture. Nowhere in the Bible do we see the book of John the Baptist. But Jesus said of John, among them that are born of women, that is the natural birth, born of the flesh, there have not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Luke 7:28 says, there have not risen a greater prophet than John the Baptist. But Jesus said, but he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist. Aren't you thankful, you and I, that have not only been born naturally, born of our mother, but thank God we've been born of the Spirit of God, and positionally, we are even greater than John the Baptist. Aren't you thankful you've been born of the Spirit this morning? Are you thankful you're in the kingdom of God? Come on now, you're in the kingdom of heaven, not because of who we are, but because of what God has done for us and in us. We are, I believe, greater in that sense than the prophet John the Baptist. The Bible says the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Romans 14:17. As I study this, we'll get to our text in a moment. You know, Isaiah and Malachi both prophesied of John the Baptist. Isaiah chapter 40 and Malachi 3 and 4, I believe it is, they prophesied not by name, but they were prophesying of John the Baptist who would come. If you will now, turn to Luke chapter 1 for our first text. I'm adding some verses with the leaflet that you have. And I want us to read verses 13 through 17 of Luke chapter 1. And let's look at John the Baptist. And you've heard me say concerning a prophet, the prophet is the mouthpiece of God. God does not yell down or speak down from heaven, although he could do that. But God speaks by the mouth of his prophet. He puts his word in that prophet's mouth. And that prophet speaks to the people the message, the word, and even the revelation that God has given him for the people. But in Luke chapter 1, beginning with verse 13, now here we have Zacharias. He's an old man. He's a priest. He's ministering in the temple. We'll touch on that in a little while. His wife's name is Elizabeth. She's old. She's barren. They have no child. He's going to burn incense at the golden altar of incense. And again, I'll look at that in a moment. But while he's ministering in the temple, verse 13, but the angel, that's Gabriel, said unto him, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. Aren't you thankful God hears the prayers of his people? Do you believe he's a prayer answering God? But he said, your prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and even named him. Thou shalt call his name John, and thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. Verse 15. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord and shall neither drink wine nor strong drink. He's going to have the Nazarite vow found in Numbers chapter 6. I'll talk about that in a moment. He's not going to drink wine nor strong drink. And I'll add, he'll not eat raisins. He'll not eat grapes. He'll eat nothing that comes of the vine. Numbers chapter 6. He's going to have long hair. The only man God allowed to have long hair was a man that had the Nazarite vow. We'll look at Samuel and Samson also. He cannot touch or approach a dead body. So he's going to be a Nazarite, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb. That is powerful. And I'm going to explain, even though he had the Holy Ghost prior to Jesus' glorification, he did not have it in the same way and for the same purpose that you and I, New Testament believers, have it this day. Amen? And I want to insert this. People believe in abortion. Here's a man here that's filled with the Holy Ghost. Some scriptures say in his mother's womb and from his mother's womb. We'll later see that when Mary is going to greet her cousin Elizabeth, who was 6 months pregnant, when Elizabeth hears Mary's salutation, a six-month-old baby in her womb is also going to hear it, is going to leap for joy in her womb. Tell me the unborn does not have feelings and emotions. Come on now. God told Jeremiah, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. That's powerful, friend. God's the one who forms in the belly. And he's going to fill this baby in the womb of his mother and from birth with the Holy Ghost. That's powerful, isn't it? Verse 16, and many of the children of Israel shall be turned to the Lord their God. In verse 17, and he shall go forth before him in the spirit and power, and that is Elias or Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. One last text, if you'll turn to Matthew chapter 11, and I know you have a leaflet that's got others you can read along too, but in Matthew chapter 11, Jesus said this in verse 10. Speaking of John, but this is he of whom it was written, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto thee, or unto you, among them that are born of women, I just touched on it, the natural birth, the flesh, as John 3 would word it, there have not risen a greater, and again, Luke 7:28 says greater prophet, than John the Baptist. Again, he is the last of the Old Testament type prophets and forerunner of the Lord Jesus Christ. I can't wait to get to Isaiah 40 here, Brother England, because he's going to go before the face of Jehovah God, but yet we're going to see he goes before the face of Jesus. That tells me Jesus is Jehovah God. Come on now, he's Yahweh, he's Jehovah God, he's the great I Am, he's the eternal spirit, he's the Lord God Almighty that was manifest in flesh. And we'll look at that in a moment. But here's what he goes on to say. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And verse 14, and if you will receive it, this is Elias or Elijah, which was for to come, that Malachi prophesied of. The Bible says of John, Brother East, that he would be the prophet of the highest. Who's the highest this morning? Jesus. Do you believe that he is the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God? Do you believe that Jesus is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto? I'll slow it down. Who no man has seen nor can see. Jesus is the highest. He is the Almighty God, and he has all power in heaven and in earth. And John, again, was the prophet of the highest. But he did no miracle, Sister Turner. That's amazing. But he comes in the spirit and power of Elijah. Elijah called fire down from heaven, did he not? He multiplied a barrel of meal and a cruse of oil. He called fire down twice upon a captain in his 50. Look at the miracles that Elijah did. While when he left, he went up in a chariot of fire and horses of fire in a tornado or a whirlwind into heaven. But here comes John the Baptist not healing the sick. He's not multiplying bread and meal. He's not calling fire down. But when he spake, friend, people listened. He spake with power. He spake with the anointing of God. He came in that spirit and power of Elijah. I believe God gave him great power to speak. And not just to speak, but he was preparing the way of the Lord Jesus, the salvation of the world. I believe that's more important than calling fire down from heaven on people. Come on now. He's going to prepare the way for our God in a desert. And all flesh is going to see the glory of the Lord. Come on now. I believe that's what made him great. And God gave him power to speak that word to the people, to turn the hearts of the children to the fathers and the hearts of the fathers to the children, that they would repent, confess their sins, and be baptized. And God would prepare through his ministry a people for the Lord. If you will now turn to Isaiah chapter 40. I love these verses, verses 3 through 5. Let's look at Scripture, and let's see, my friends, how Scripture fulfills Scripture. Many times when you look in the Old Testament, the prophecies that were given about God coming or God doing certain things, Brother Turner, were ultimately fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Let's look at this. Because again, Isaiah is speaking of John the Baptist, though he does not call him by name. Verse 3. And many call Isaiah the messianic prophet because of Isaiah 7:14, Isaiah 9:6, Isaiah chapter 53. But here he says, "The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord." And I want to stop there. When you see the word Lord in the Old Testament writings, in all uppercase letters, I'll say capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, or again, all uppercase letters, it is put there in the place of Jehovah. Now, some say it would be rendered Yahweh, and I believe the Bible renders it Yahweh, maybe even one that would render it Jehovah. But in our Bibles, it would have been rendered Jehovah. So the translators, 6,823 times, according to a book I have that was written back in the 60s, and Brother England, I haven't tried to count them all. But this brother, apostolic brother, said 6,823 times, and I think he said maybe more, something like that, we find Lord in all uppercase letters in the Old Testament. So when we see this in Isaiah chapter 40, and I'm going slower for my friends here. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, talking about John. Here's a man with garment made of camel hair. He ate locusts, wild honey. He had long hair because he was a Nazarite. He was like a hermit. My wife tells me I'm a loner. But he's like a hermit, a recluse. Jesus even said how, you know, John didn't come eating and drinking, fellowshipping. He was like a recluse. He was in the wilderness for years until the word of the Lord God came to him. And between Malachi and John, there was about 400 years of silence. There was no prophet of God. There was no vision or open revelation from the Holy One. There was 400 years from Malachi to John, approximately, that God did not speak to his people. But again, John is to prepare the way of, everyone say Jehovah. Everyone say Yahweh. Say the Lord. Everyone say uppercase letters. But isn't it amazing, Brother England, when we see John standing up and ministering, he is preparing the way for Jesus. He said, there's one coming after me. He's mightier than I. Come on now. I'm not worthy to bear his shoes. He's going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Woo! And John said he was preferred before me because he was before me. But you know, Sister Hunt, when I look in Scripture, John was 6 months older than Jesus. So when Jesus said in so many words, John said in so many words, Jesus was before me, couldn't be talking about his humanity. Being the eternal spirit, being the I am, being Jehovah God, come on now, being the Lord God Almighty, Jesus was before John. He was before all things and before all people. Brother Johnson, Jesus said before Abraham was, I am. They said, man, you're not even 50 years old. Have you seen Abraham? Not speaking of his humanity, but being the eternal spirit, being the omnipresent God, Jesus is the great I am. He's preferred before John, and he was before John. Thank God he was before all things, and by him all things consist. Clap your hands unto the Lord. I'm trying to slow it down and go at the same time here. Glory. So he's going to prepare the way for Jehovah God. He's going to make straight. There's some crooked ways, Brother East, that John's going to make straight. In the desert, look at this. Let Scripture interpret Scripture. In the desert, a highway for our God. Not for God the Son, not for the second person of a Trinity. But Brother Johnson, he's going to make a highway for our God, and our God is Jesus. Come on now. He's Jehovah God. He's Yahweh God. He's the I am. He's El Shaddai. He is the Almighty God. And John, who was his relative or cousin, according to the flesh, is going to prepare the way for him. John's even going to baptize him. Not that it was needed, but in order to fulfill all righteousness, he's going to baptize his relative, Jesus, and he's going to see the heavens open, and all of a sudden the Holy Ghost in the form of a dove is going to descend upon Christ. The man Christ Jesus is going to be anointed, and John's going to hear a voice saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. You mean the Father was in Christ? You mean God was in Christ? Sure he was. Sister Betsy, the Bible says God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. God was manifest in the flesh. Jesus said, the Father is in me, he dwelleth in me. Colossians 1:19, for it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. So Jesus is our God. He is the embodiment of the eternal spirit who is the Father. And John went to prepare the way of Jehovah God and make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Verse 4 of Isaiah 40. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain, and the glory of Jehovah. Thank you, Lord. John said, we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. And other scriptures bring out, they shall see the salvation of our God. Do you know who you believe this morning? Somebody say, praise the Lord. John said, he that cometh from heaven is above all. He's mightier than I. Again, he was before me. He's preferred before. You know, it's all about Jesus, isn't it, Sister Reynolds? I've got to decrease. He must increase. And when our good pastor allows me to minister here, you know what my desire is? I don't want you to see Brad Blanton. I really don't. Now, I may wear a colored suit, Brother East, but I don't want you to see me. I want you to see the power of God operating through me. I want you to see the anointing of God and the knowledge of God going forth. And the less you see of me, and I say it from the heart, and the more you see of God and of His Word, the more successful I am. To God be the glory. Come on now. He that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. God's not going to share His glory with another, Brother England. Years ago, I say this to His glory. I was just starting out doing a little bit of exhorting, testifying, and when I got through speaking a few words, the power of God was so strong, an older lady came to me and said, when you were speaking, I saw God all over you. And she said, that's the greatest compliment that I can give you. And I thought, yes, ma'am, that's the greatest compliment you can give me. It's all about Jesus and preparing and helping prepare a people for the Lord. That's what Brother Hunt and the ministers are pressing for, preparing people to meet their God. Amen? Praise the Lord. So again, Isaiah and Malachi prophesied, not by name, but by the appearing of John the Baptist. Now let's look at Luke. Let's go back for a few moments to his birth. And we're going to talk about when he talks about the Holy Ghost baptism here in a few moments. Here again we have a man by the name of Zacharias. He's an old priest. There's 24 divisions of courses of the priest. He was in the 8th division or course of Abijah. And Zacharias was a righteous man according to the law. He, his wife, Elizabeth, were well stricken in age. They were old. So God can open the womb of a barren woman. Make her a wife and a joyful mother and a keeper of house. Here's an old couple. They're well stricken in age. Now, in those days, if a woman did not have a child, it was a reproach if she was barren. That was their custom. Zacharias is a priest. His wife, Elizabeth, is barren. They're old. But as I was reading this, it came back to me of Abraham and Sarah. Abraham is going to have a son when he's 90. His half-sister, Sarah, princess, is going to be 90. Abraham's going to be 100. I say 100 for Abraham and 90. Out of a dead womb, Brother Johnson, God, He is the one who quickens the dead. He brings to life that which is dead. I said it earlier. The womb is dead. Abraham's dead. May I say, Zacharias and Elizabeth are dead as far as having a child, but God quickens the dead. Come on now. He opened the womb of Hannah and gave her a son named Samuel, who also was a Nazarite. He appeared to Manoah's wife, and she was barren, and the angel said to her, you're going to have a son. He's going to be a Nazarite from birth to the day of his death. Samson. God opened the womb of Rebekah. God allowed a virgin to have the Christ. We serve a miracle working God this morning. Come on now. He quickens the dead spiritually, physically. And oh, hallelujah. He's a God of the living and not of the dead. Blessed be the name of the Lord God. But they're old. They're well stricken in years. Here's the temple now. Zacharias, no doubt, they've gone by the way of the brazen altar in the outer court, by the way of the laver for the washing of the hands and the feet in the temple. Now he enters in. To the left is the golden candlesticks. To the right is a table of shewbread or showbread, where 12 loaves of hot bread are placed every Sabbath for the priest. Directly in front of him as he enters into that first sanctuary is the golden altar of incense. Right up against the veil, the purple, blue, white, scarlet veil. And on the other side of the veil is the most holy place, commonly called the Holy of Holies, or is the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat. His lot fell. Evidently, they cast lots some way to determine what their service was in the temple. So his lot fell to burn incense. So Sister Edith, he had a censer in his hand. He put incense in it and coals of fire from the brazen altar. And he went in with his censer of fire, and the incense was burning and ascending up into the nostrils of God. God just gave me this. Do you know that your prayer is like sweet incense unto God? When you enter into your prayer closet and you pray, it's a sweet smell or savor in the nostrils of Almighty God. God craved. God told me years ago, and I'm not one that says God talks to me. God said, I crave your worship. Told me that. Came so distinctly to me. I crave it. God craves our worship and our prayer. So he enters in to burn incense, and as he looks to the right of the golden altar of incense is Gabriel, the angel of God. He appears to him. And what we read in Luke chapter 1, if you want to flip back there, we'll kind of look at it just for a moment here. The angel of God speaks to him and tells him in verse 13, your prayer is heard. Your wife is going to bear a son. And you know that all three Nazarites came from barren women. I just touched on it. Hannah prayed and God gave her Samuel, which means ask of God. El is a root for God. And again, the angel spoke to a barren woman, Manoah's wife, and said, you're going to have a son. He's Samson, and he's going to be a Nazarite. Now, here's another woman who's old and barren, and the angel of God says to her, you're going to have, or to him, you're going to have, by your wife, of course, John the Baptist, and he will be a Nazarite. He's not going to drink wine nor strong drink, and again, he's going to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, when Zechariah hears this, verse 18, he doesn't believe him because he says, I am an old man, and my wife is well stricken in years. And I'll move along and say this. The angel smote him to where he was dumb for 9 months. He could not talk, Brother Johnson, for 9 months because he did not believe the angel of God. And so later in Luke chapter 1, I won't turn there, we find that Gabriel is going to appear now, not an old woman. She's not barren, a young virgin woman, a young teenage girl, some say, named Mary. And the angel is going to announce to Mary, you're going to have a son. The power of the highest is going to be a miraculous conception and birth. The power of the highest is going to overshadow you, and you're going to bring forth the Son of God. And Mary then goes to visit her cousin, Elizabeth, who's now 6 months pregnant. I've already touched on it. And when Mary greets its worded cousin or relative, Elizabeth, John the Baptist, again, is 6 months old in Elizabeth's womb, this old lady's womb, is going to hear the voice of the mother of the Christ-to-be, is going to leap in her womb for joy, is what Elizabeth said. The baby, again, could hear. He was a human being. He had feelings. He had emotions. He leaped for joy. And you know, church, sometimes we say, there ain't no rock going to take my place. I wonder if a six-month-old unborn baby is going to take our place. I believe we need to leap for joy sometime and give God praise and honor and glory. For thank God he had done great things. He had dealt bountifully and wondrously with you and I who are in the kingdom of heaven, born of the Spirit of God. And now, I don't get in politics to another man's ministry. I will say this one thing. Years ago, when women had the right to smoke, and I'm 59 years old, they had a commercial, showed a woman fingers, and they said, you've come a long way, baby. Now you know what they rejoice in? That they've come a long way? You can kill your babies. That's what Hillary Clinton wants, to kill nine-month-old babies. Abomination in the sight of God. Put colored lights on the White House when a man can marry a man, a woman can marry a woman. God will destroy a nation for these things. Somebody say amen or oh me. Now I'm getting off of that. I'll leave that to Brother Zombie. Praise the Lord. But go ahead and turn there. We've got a little few moments. Luke chapter 1. Look at verse 41 and 44. And it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, she went to spend some time with her. The baby leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. Verse 44, now Elizabeth said, for lo, as soon as the voice of thy salutation sounded in mine ears, the babe leaped in my womb, and she added, for joy. That's powerful, isn't it? So John the Baptist is going to come forth filled with the Holy Ghost from Elizabeth's womb. Elizabeth is also filled with the Holy Ghost, verse 41. And if you'll go down to verse 66, when John the Baptist is born, Zacharias is going to be filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesy. But for 9 months, he's dumb, he's speechless, because he did not believe the word of the angel of God, Gabriel. But when John was born, they circumcised him on the eighth day and gave him their name. They called, family and friends came around and said, we're going to name him Zacharias. Zacharias, in so many words, said no. Called for like a table or a tablet and wrote on it, his name is John. And when he said the right name, sister, God loosed his tongue. He was filled with the Holy Ghost, and he prophesied. Don't tell me a name's not important. I know a name that is important, and it's Jesus. Can you say amen? And if you'll call on the name of Jesus, he'll loose your tongue to speak in words and languages you've never learned before. He'll fill you with the Holy Ghost. Can you say amen this morning? Glory to God. So they were. Here's a Holy Ghost-filled family. Babies filled with the Holy Ghost. Mothers filled with the Holy Ghost. Father filled with the Holy Ghost. The parents prophesy. But I want to say this. The Holy Ghost was not yet given, John 7:39, because Jesus was not yet glorified. So what does that mean? Here's what it means. Even though they received the Holy Spirit. Now the translators put the word ghost there. I'll explain it in a moment. I've got time. They received the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost prior to Jesus Christ, but they were not born again like you and I are. The office or the manifestation of the Spirit of God as the abiding comforter was not yet available, was not yet until Jesus was glorified. God had to be in Christ. Christ would have to be tempted and suffer and die and be resurrected and glorified, and then pour out the Holy Ghost upon the people that would receive it. So the office or manifestation of the Comforter, with all the priestly mediation and intercessory grace, was not yet available until Jesus was glorified. Though it said they had the Holy Ghost, and they did prior to Christ, again, it was a different manifestation or office of the Spirit of God in the Old Testament believers. And I'll get on that another time, because there's something I want to really touch you on. Turn, if you will, to Matthew chapter 3. I've got 10 minutes. John's preaching, preparing the way. Multitudes of people, Brother Turner, thousands of men and women are coming out to hear John the Baptist. He's standing there with a garment made of camel hair. He may have a little wild honey in his beard. Again, he's a Nazarite, number 6. You can look at that later. It was a vow, sister, that a man would take or a woman would take. And in that vow of separation and consecration unto God, again, they could not drink wine. They could not drink grape juice. They couldn't eat raisins or grapes, and they could not approach a dead person, or they would be defiled. The token of that vow, I guess I'd use the word token, was he grew long hair and usually would have 7 strands. Now, that does not apply to New Testament, because that was an Old Testament vow that people could choose to take or not to take. Under the New Testament, Paul said it's a shame for a man to have long hair. But God did permit it for this vow called the Nazarite vow. Now, some people feel Jesus was a Nazarite. He was not a Nazarite. He was from a town called Nazareth, but that did not make him a Nazarite. Jesus did drink of the fruit of the vine, and he did touch dead bodies. Matter of fact, the widow of Nain, thank you, Lord, only son. Jesus went up and stopped the funeral procession, went up and touched the bier, the casket, or that which held the casket. If he was a Nazarite, he would have been defiled. He went to Lazarus' tomb and said, Lazarus, come forth. Now, I said, I've covered so much here. Again, Samuel and Samson were Nazarites. So they had long hair. All of these things they had to abstain from is found in Numbers chapter 6. So John the Baptist is preaching. He's trying to prepare the way for the Lord, or he is preparing the way for the Lord. God Almighty, the salvation and glory of our God. He's wanting the hearts of the children to be turned to the fathers and the fathers to the children. He's wanting them to repent of their sins, confess their sins, turn to God, and be baptized for the remission of sins. Now in Matthew chapter 3, the Bible tells us, Brother England, that a multitude of people went out to John the Baptist. That whole region, there were literally thousands of men and women who went out to hear this man with his beard and seven long strands and camel's hair, wild honey maybe in his beard, and locust wings in his beard. But there was not a prophet like him because of his mission and the spirit and power, no doubt, by which he spake. Now, the Church of Christ, and yes, I said Church of Christ, this is where they teach. Only the 12 apostles received the Holy Ghost in Acts chapter 2. Or only the 12 received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Well, let's let Scripture interpret Scripture, Brother Johnson. You know this. John was not talking to 12 apostles. John the Baptist was preaching to thousands of men and women, and as he would baptize that woman, as he would baptize that man, by immersion, he told them, thousands of them, there's one coming after me. In John 1:29, he told some, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. There's one coming after me. He's mightier than I. Woo! He's the Almighty God manifest in flesh, the Father in the Son, the Eternal Spirit in the Messiah. Just like I've immersed you in the water, he's going to immerse you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. He's going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost. He wasn't talking to Peter and James and John and only the 12. He spoke to thousands of people. And in Acts chapter 2, Brother Daniel, when I see the scripture recording what happened, there were men and women that receive the Holy Ghost. And all the ladies, I said, amen. I've done that before. It shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. Everyone say all flesh. All flesh shall see the glory of the Lord. All flesh shall see the salvation of our God. Come on now. Men and women, God will pour out of his spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your young men shall see visions, your old men shall dream dreams, and on my servants and on my handmaidens, all the women said amen, I will in those days pour out of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. Sister Leatherwood, this is for everyone. It wasn't just for 12 apostles. This is the salvation of our God. Clap your hands on the Lord and give him praise. Ooh, I got about 4.5-5 minutes left. Glory to the Lord. And I believe today if you'll come to God and you'll repent, you'll confess your sins, and you'll be baptized by immersion in the name of Jesus Christ, God will fill you, or Jesus will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Can you say amen? Scripture says this, John 1:6-8, that John came to bear witness of that light. Do you believe that Jesus was the light of the world? You and I now that are in the kingdom of heaven, you and I that have been born of the Spirit of God, we're children of light. We're like a city on a hill. Come on now, candle, don't put it under a bushel. But thank God there's a song that says, this little light of mine, what? I'm going to let it shine. We're to show forth the praises of him who hath called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. You remember years ago, there was an old crazy commercial. It was a black man, bald-headed man. It was called the Cola Nut. Talking about 7-Up. He said, marvelous. Thank God this is marvelous light. Come on now. We got something to shout about. Marvelous. Thank God he's still doing marvelous things, wondrous things. And again, in John 1:29, as I'm coming to a close here, he said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. John 3, the Bible says of John the Baptist, he was a friend of the bridegroom, Sister Leatherwood. Jesus is the bridegroom. The church is the bride. Who wants to be a friend of the Lord Jesus Christ? There's a song we sing, I'm a friend of God. I'm a friend of the bridegroom. Friend, if you're his wife, you're his bride, you're his church, thank God you better be his friend. Glory to God. Woo. Hallelujah. Do you know who you serve today? John said, he must increase, but I must decrease. Now, I did a little study. Most say John the Baptist's ministry lasted about 6 months. Some say several months. I'd heard maybe a year or two, but most say about 6 months. Can you imagine now, here's a man all these years in the desert with a Nazarite vow, living in, being a recluse, like a loner, to minister for approximately 6 months, if this is correct, for 6 months. But again, Jesus said there's no greater prophet than he. He didn't lay down one night and go to sleep, not wake up. They cut his head off. But you know, it's all about Jesus this morning. It's not about you. It's not about I. We have our part and our place, but it's all about the Lord Jesus. God bless you this morning. Would you stand and lift up your hands and give God praise as we change the order of our service? He's still a miracle working God. Do you love? Well, come on, lift up your voice. Cry out to God one more time. Father, we love you this morning, God, with all of our hearts. We're so thankful, God, for your anointing. God, for your spirit. Father, for your presence. And it's our desire, Lord, to magnify Jesus. It's our desire, Lord, to tell others about you, that, God, they might be prepared, that they, Lord, might be saved. And, God, may you continue to bless our services this day. We ask it in Jesus' name. God bless you this morning. Shake somebody's hand and say you're glad to see them in Sunday school today.